A group of seven finance ministers pledged more aid for Ukraine. Together with the international community, they pledged to provide additional support for Ukraine in excess of $24 billion for 2022 and beyond. They add that international organizations should no longer conduct business activities with Russia. This as Russia participated in the G20, IMF, and World Bank meetings this week. The group of seven is composed of the UK, the US, Canada, Japan, Germany, France, and Italy. Top finance officials from the US, Britain, and Canada walk out of Wednesday's G20 meeting in Washington as Russian representatives began to speak. The UK's finance minister, Rishi Sunak, announced what happened on Twitter, saying that the move shows that they're united in condemning Russia's war in Ukraine. He adds that they will continue to push for stronger international cooperation to punish Moscow. US Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen walked out together with the governor of the Bank of England, Andrew Bailey, Canada's finance minister, Chrystia Freeland, and some Ukrainian officials. The G20's finance ministers and central bank governors met on the sidelines of a semi-annual conference held by the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank, with the war in Ukraine, food security, and the ongoing recovery from the pandemic as their key topics. Russia successfully tests a powerful intercontinental ballistic missile, a weapon Vladimir Putin, President Vladimir Putin, says will make the Kremlin's enemies think twice. According to Putin, the Sarmat missile is capable of evading all modern anti-missile defense systems, as it gives enemy surveillance systems just a tiny window to track it. The test comes after Russia launched a major offensive aimed at capturing Ukraine's eastern Donbas region to create a land corridor to annex Crimea. The U.S., however, downplays that missile test, saying it isn't deemed a threat. Ukraine and Russia reach a preliminary agreement to establish a humanitarian corridor to evacuate women, children, and the elderly from the besieged city of Mariupol. Residents there will be evacuated to Ukraine's southern city of Zaporizhzhia, passing through the Berdyansk town, which is currently controlled by Russian forces. Mariupol's mayor says that Ukraine is sending 90 buses to the besieged city to evacuate about 6,000 civilians. The European Union will do everything possible to help Ukraine win the war against Russia. That vow coming from the EU's chief, Charles Michel. During a visit to Kiev, Michel also signaled his support for Ukraine's membership in the EU.
I am, and we are extremely impressed by your personal leadership. And your personal leadership is also showing the bravery and the courage of the people of Ukraine. You are not alone. We are with you, and we'll do everything which is possible, you know, to support you and to make sure that Ukraine will win the war.
Meanwhile, the head of the United Nations, Antonio Guterres, has sent letters to Russian President Vladimir Putin and his Ukrainian counterpart, Volodymyr Zelensky, requesting for a meeting. This is Guterres' hopes to spur dialogue in a bid to end the nearly two-month-old war. The U.S. takes aim at Bitcoin miners operating in Russia in its latest round of sanctions against Moscow. Russia is the world's third biggest destination for Bitcoin mining. Among the companies targeted is BitRiver, which operates its mining farms with hydroelectric power. They also employ over 200 full-time staff in three offices across Russia. The U.S. says by operating vast server farms that sell virtual currency mining capacities internationally, these companies help Russia monetize its natural resources. Washington adds that they are committed to ensuring that no asset becomes a mechanism for the Putin regime to offset the impact of all the sanctions against them. Personnel at the U.S. Capitol are now allowed to return inside the building following an emergency evacuation order. Capitol Police earlier ordered the evacuation of all the people there after an aircraft they were tracking posed a possible threat. They have since, however, issued a swift update to say that the aircraft does not pose any danger. After about an hour, allowing staff to return inside the building. Neither the House nor the Senate were in session at this time. Local media reports say that the aircraft turned out to be from the military conducting a performance at a nearby baseball stadium.